to see you all. We have a mirror attendance to that, so bless you for being here. Glad you're here. It happened in first service, too. I think apparently people are having trouble with the new year and getting up and all that kind of stuff, but I am glad you're here. Today we celebrate Epiphany. The day was yesterday, which opens to the season of Epiphany, which is now till Lent. So we're celebrating Epiphany today, and it's all about light and stars and seeking God's presence and knowing that God is with us, and so we'll celebrate that today. We will touch on the story of the wise men, but we will emphasize the story of the light of Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Then let us turn to God using the call to worship that is printed. People of God, rejoice. The light of the world has come. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. People of God, give thanks. We have received this light of life and are called to share that light in the world.
Arise, shine, our light has come.
Morning, stand as you are able, and please join us in singing a certain song.
Your grace. Happy New Year, everybody.
Oh,
I am going to have a children's turn. So come on down, and the main reason is because I'm going to make sure that children's time is a little bit for everybody. We just sang. Welcome. You want me to come to you? Your way. We just sang about the three kings, or the three wise men, or the three magi that are in the, they're not even named as three in the scripture, but which you'll hear in just a minute from Nalleli. But they brought gifts. What did they bring? Gold, frankincense, somebody heard, and myrrh. Okay, you know what gold is. It's worth stuff, money. Sometimes turned into jewelry and stuff like that, but it's valuable, so it's something worthy and money related. There's a picture up here for everybody. There's a picture here for you too of the gold is in the middle. You can tell that because it's a big nugget. The pale one is the frankincense, and this is the myrrh. And actually, this is real myrrh. It hasn't been refined as much as that. So it's a little darker, but this is real myrrh. And this is really refined into an oil of frankincense. So I'm going to make you smell it. Kind of an interesting, spicy smell. If anybody else feels inclined to smell myrrh, frankincense, sorry, it'll be up here in the front after the service, and you can feel free to. So anyway, it is kind of a spicy thing that was used in worship. People, and it still is, there are still places where people burn frankincense to remind them of the smell of holiness, and it's used in worship. So we got the gold that is for Jesus being king and wealthy and powerful, and so it's to remind us of those things. The worship, the frankincense is to remind us of worship. And myrrh was used either ground up or burned, like the frankincense, it could become an oil. It was used in medicines for healing often, and still is, I think. And sometimes was used for embalming and burial fluids and liquids and oils and stuff. So you got the gold, it's kind of obvious that Jesus is the king. You got the frankincense that reminds us of Jesus, that we should worship Jesus. And then you got the myrrh. Why do you think the myrrh was used? It's for healing and for the embalming. And the embalming is to remind us of Jesus' death and resurrection. And the healing is that God can heal us and Jesus can heal us, but also that Jesus offers us resurrection. So all three of these things were offered by the kings, which I've heard many people say, you know, those were not very practical gifts for the baby, which is probably true, but they were symbolic gifts to remind us of who Jesus is, that these people, when they came to see this baby, they saw more than just a baby. And that's true of us too. When we come to Jesus, we see more than just a baby. We see Jesus as king, someone to be worshipped, someone who can bring healing, and someone who conquers death, in fact. That's what those were about. That's about all we're doing with the kings today, so that you got it all. So let's say prayer. Dear God, thank you for gifts. Help us to remember to share all you have given. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much.
The first scripture reading is Matthew 2:1-12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, magi from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star in the east and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod secretly called for the Magi and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen in the east, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. Next reading is John 1:1-5. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things came into being through him. And without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overtake it. And John 8:12. Again, Jesus spoke to him, saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but have the light of life." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So, yesterday was Epiphany, the day, but the season continues, and we are celebrating the season of Epiphany from now until Lent begins. That's always true. Lent varies when it starts, but from now until Epiphany, until Lent is Epiphany. So we have a whole season of Epiphany. I thought I'd talk about what it means. The actual word means manifestation, as in God is manifest, God is known. Or revelation, as in God is revealed. In this case, seeing God and knowing God and understanding God more fully during this season. That's what Epiphany is about. We see God. Light and sight and insight are all important ideas that we think about during this time, images for this season of Epiphany. And during the season, the church thinks about how God is revealed in the world, how we see God in the world, how we come to understand God, how we come to know God. And for us, it is primarily through Jesus Christ. We see God through Jesus. And then, beyond that, how we might share what we know and see of who God is, how we might share the light of God and God's love in the world, so that others might then see and understand and know, come to know God more fully. So we think of the story of the wise men, the visit of the Magi, as a Christmas story, but closing off the narrative of the birth story. But in the church year, it actually begins the whole season of Epiphany. And in many other parts of the world, Epiphany is actually a bigger season than Christmas in some ways. In the church, and it is the season of Epiphany is, and the story of the wise men is the first of the biblical stories for the season. And we'll be looking at other stories next week and following that are traditionally about Epiphany, about seeing God's revelation in the world, seeing the light in the world. The story of Matthew from the visit of the wise men shows how Jesus extended God's light beyond the people of God, beyond the traditional Israelite people, beyond that little corner of the world. How Jesus extends God's light to everyone in the world. How God through Jesus extends love to everyone in the world, even these foreign visitors, even these people who should not have been able to see God, saw God in Jesus Christ. The star, which guided the Magi, the kings, to the Christ child, has then become a symbol of seeing and understanding, a symbol of this season of Epiphany. A star shining God's light and guiding the way to God for all people, all who seek. So seeking and looking for guidance has become part of this season as well. The readings from John develop that image of light and darkness and God's light in Jesus Christ, light of the world. And God calls us to shine Christ's light in the world throughout this season of Epiphany and beyond. The idea of God as light of the world, God as light, is not new. This has been throughout the Bible, especially in the Psalms and the Prophets. God is referred to as light often. The Gospel of John just picks that up, and that understanding of God as light, and develops it further and applies it specifically to Jesus, who is God in the flesh. How is Jesus the light of the world? Jesus helps us see God. Jesus helps us understand God. Jesus reveals God to us and the truth of who God is, God's love for the world. Jesus shows us what it means that God loves us. And Jesus is the light of God shining in the darkness of the world. This time of year, as it is dark more often, as the sun goes down early and rises later, and there is more darkness in the world, we understand the importance of light. It is in a symbolic sense, it's easy to understand darkness as the absence of God, or the absence even of good, or the absence of life. So if John connected it and has connected it for us, then we think of light versus darkness and the light of the world shining into the darkness of the world. Now, unfortunately, it is still too easy to see darkness in the world, to understand the lack of good and the lack of God in the world. We see war and violence and suffering and cruelty, and it's hard to see the hope of the world and to concentrate on what is good in the world. Jesus reminds us that God is here even amid the darkness. God is with us even when we can't see that God is with us. Jesus reminds us to look for God then, to look for the good, to look for the bright spots and the way to move into brighter light and better days. And further, to share that light whenever possible, to shine the light of Jesus Christ, to show other people where the light is and how to feel God's grace. Seeing the light of Christ is in fact more than an attitude or positive thinking. It is a way of living, opening our eyes to God at all times, in all places, seeing God. In fact, John describes it as living in Jesus, not just living with Jesus, not just knowing Jesus, but living inside Jesus, as if we are in Jesus, so we're no longer living in this world of darkness. Rather, we are living inside Jesus in the kingdom which has already begun, God's kingdom in which God is the rule. We live in the light of God. We walk in the light of God. Everywhere we go, God's light is with us. And we see the world as Jesus sees the world, filled with hope and possibility and goodness. Now, that doesn't mean you don't see the dark things. You don't feel the darkness sometimes. It means that because we know the light of God, the light of Jesus Christ, we can see that there are answers to the darkness. That light is here even amid dark moments and dark times. We see that we are not alone in the darkness. God is always with us. There are ways to get through dark times. We all know that. Sometimes it's hard to remember, but there are ways to get through dark times, to shine the light. There are ways to help other people find the good in the world and feel the presence of love in the world, to point people toward God's love. There are ways to do that, and that, in a nutshell, is what Epiphany is all about. Helping other people see and experience God's presence, helping other people see the light, even when things are dark. That's what Epiphany is about. So I have realized that everything I've said so far has been very abstract and very theological. And in some ways that's good. In other ways, take a nice nap. Turning to very, very practical, so wake up if you were asleep. The season of Epiphany this year is very short in 2024 because the season ends with Lent beginning, and the time of Lent changes a lot. So this year, Epiphany is only 6 Sundays long, which is one of the shorter times that it can be. Epiphany is from now, from yesterday, through February 14th. The last Sunday is February 11th. So February 14th is Ash Wednesday, also happens to be Valentine's Day. Something significant in there. Epiphany is, in fact, this year, exactly 40 days. Often we have 40 days of Lent, and we think of that as a time for preparation. So I'm inviting you this year to think of Epiphany as an intense time of preparation or action called by God to shine the light of God. A concentrated time to focus on the light of Jesus Christ, to look for the light of God, to see God and all the good that God places before you. Your invitation, you have 6 weeks to shine the light of Jesus, to show God's love, to point people toward God, to see God, and to help other people see God. That's the point of Epiphany. So your invitation is to take this next 6 weeks to do that. Of course, you can do it anytime, and I invite you to continue showing God's love anytime, even past Epiphany, but it's a nice concentrated way to think about it. And if you accept the challenge of Epiphany this year, I invite you to take the next 6 weeks to be very intentional about shining the light of Jesus. Focus on God, make it a priority, and then find concrete ways of shining the light of Jesus Christ, of helping other people to see God. And there are a lot of ways to do that. You can do it any way you want to do that. But I'm going to give 2 suggestions. You can pick whatever works for you. You can do something else entirely. So the first option, there are 40 days. So with 40 days, take every single day of the 40 days. Think of something to do every single day to shine God's light or share God's love, which is saying the same thing. Do something every day to point toward Jesus, to share God's love in Jesus Christ. Now, that can be as simple as smiling at somebody, or helping somebody with a chore, or doing a good deed, or expressing a kind word, or saying a prayer for someone, anyone, everyone in the world. Every single day, do one good thing, one random act of kindness, one thing to point people toward God. And you can choose to do the same thing every day. So every day I'm going to smile at somebody. You can smile at the same person for 40 days straight. They'll think you're crazy. No, they will love feeling that experience and feeling that gift of God. You can do the same thing every single day, like the same chore or the same prayer or the same whatever. Or you can mix it up for 40 days and do 40 different things. 40 different ways of sharing kindness and shining God's light in the world, showing God's love. From now until Valentine's Day, February 14th, Ash Wednesday. But if you do this, if you choose to do this, I'm warning you, if you do an act of kindness every single day, if you think about trying to find something to share God's light every single day, be careful, it's contagious. You will think of more than one thing every single day to do. You will find more and more ways of being kind and sharing God's light and seeing God and helping other people to see God. If you do something every single day, you might end up doing more than one thing every day. You might end up doing it longer than 40 days. So it's a challenge, accept it or not, as you wish. The other option is, instead of every single day doing it, maybe make it a weekly challenge. Maybe it's something that will take longer than a day. Or maybe it is, you'll set aside every Saturday or every Thursday or whatever works for you, one bigger project every week from now until then. Now that's only 6 projects. That's only 6 things you have to think about. Something that will shine the light of Jesus Christ, that will show the love of God in the world. It will help someone else Help yourself as well to see God in the world and to shine God's light. So pick either way that you like doing it, or do both if you like doing that, or don't do either if you want to come up with your own way of shining God's light and sharing God's love in the world. It is up to us to choose how to seek God and see God in the world. In order to do this, in order to share the light of God, in order to share the love of God, in order to help people see Jesus and help see God's love in the world, think about it. You first have to see the light yourself. You first have to see God. So start there. Start by looking for God every single day. And hopefully seeing God every single day. Open your eyes and you will see God. Look for it. God promises to be with us. If we seek the presence of God in the world, we will find and we will notice the love of God all around us. Today, for instance, where do you see God? How do you see God today? Right now, even. Do you see God? Where do you see God? I've seen God all morning. All morning here. Each day, how will you seek God? How will you find God? How will you see the light and be able to shine the light? I'll say, you've done a great job already. You are already seeking God because you're here. If you weren't seeking God, you'd be somewhere else or you'd be asleep. So you've already started today turning to the light of God, seeking God's presence. You have already made that step. Thank God. And you're listening for God's word revealed. In a few minutes, we are going to share communion, which we do often, monthly at least. Communion for us is one of the clearest ways that we see Jesus. We see Jesus in the bread broken, in the cup poured. They remind us of all the activities of Jesus in the world and in our personal lives, of all the ways that we are one together, united with people all over the world, all the ways that we share God's love, because God has first loved us. So communion is one of the most concrete ways in our worship experience that we can see Jesus. We feel God's love together. We open ourselves to God's presence and literally ask God to enter us and feed us and fill us with new life and new possibility. We are filled by the Holy Spirit of God. That's the promise. If we turn to God, God will show God's self to us. We will see God. So that we're able then to be strengthened and feel the presence and the power of the Spirit of God, and then go out into the world and share what we have received. Share the light of Jesus' love and be kind and loving to others and show other people God's presence in the world. That's the blessing of Epiphany. That's the blessing of gathering together in community, that we are able to strengthen each other and help each other to see God and to experience the presence of God in the world. So today, now, and as we receive communion in a few moments, receive that blessing of God, that gift of God, that power of God, and know that God loves you, that the light of God shines with you and on you and through you into the world. And then as you go out into the world, share all that you have received.
Here I am to say that you're my God.
Feast with all of your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, light of the world, who taught us to pray as we now pray together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We today, as is our custom, will receive the elements by intinction, that is, we'll have elders come forward and serve bread and juice. Take the bread first and dip it into the cup, receiving both at the same time. If you would prefer not to have the elements open, there are prepackaged elements in the back that you can receive and take and peel, and they are sanitary. I did use this. I have been coughing, but I did use this, and elders will like to do that as well, because there's a lot going on. But we will then receive all of God's gifts and go back to our seats at that point. If there's anybody, I'm not seeing anybody who needs help walking or would prefer not to walk, we can take the elements to you, so just stay in your spot and spot you agree to. Having said all that, the Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread, ordinary table bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it and said, This is my body broken for you. Do this remembering me. In the same way, Jesus took the cup after supper and said, This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this remembering Jesus. For every time you eat of this bread or drink from this cup, you proclaim the death of our Lord Jesus Christ until Christ comes again in glory. These gifts, indeed, are the gifts of God for all the people of God, giving thanks to God. Bring the elders forward. You know who you want.
Thank you.
God, giver of new life, giver of constant love. We thank you for your presence with us always, for these symbols of your love given. We pray, nourished by this holy meal, by this fellowship, by this community and communion, renew us in faith and hope that we may welcome Jesus, that we may see signs of your grace all around us, that we may share those signs and help other people to see you and to know your love. We pray, looking forward in hope, to that day when all will know your love and everyone will sing your praise. We pray, come, Lord Jesus, even so quickly come to the glory of our God and Savior. Amen.
Will you stand as you are able to join us in song as we conclude the day's service?
Spirit be with you now and evermore. Amen. Amen.